good morning, everyone. You will be unsurprised to hear that I believe Tom Tugendhat should be our next Prime Minister. Tom and I met in 2015 on our first day as MPs. Since then, I've got to know him, his family, those who he served alongside, and our shared outlook in the world has turned out to be very similar. Like me, he is a conviction politician, unashamedly willing to stand up for what he believes in and to kick down doors to make things happen for his constituents, for his country, and for our global family. His leadership record over a decade serving in the military, playing a vital role in the reconstruction in Iraq, just to name but one area, will shape our outlook as the UK on the world stage and at home. And while Putin's illegal invasion rages on, the people of Ukraine look to reconstruction. And I know that Tom's commitment to continuing our UK leadership in rebuilding lives, homes, roads and infrastructure will be unwavering. And we also must look to crack on with the maximisation of the benefits of Brexit. Everywhere I travel in the world, countries want to do business with the United Kingdom. They want our products and our services. They want our culture and our values. But you know what? For too long, we have done ourselves down as a country. So it's time for a fresh start. And I know that Tom will champion Great Britain and Northern Ireland and the businesses that make us world class. He will make the UK once again the best place for businesses to invest and grow. Closer to home over the next few months, we are going to be faced with some tough decisions. I know that Tom will steer the nation through the storm, seizing the global opportunities Brexit has given to grow our economy. He is the person to unite our party and our country with a clear vision to enrich lives across every part of our great nation. So I'm backing Tom for Prime Minister for four reasons. First, his ambition for the future of the UK, backing Britain on the world stage as we forge ahead with our world trade deals and the reforms still needed to make Brexit the springboard to the UK success that I campaigned for. Second, his bravery in making difficult decisions that will need to be taken, tackling the cost of living, sorting out NHS backlogs, primary care, and growing our economy. Third, his commitment, genuine, passionate commitment to protecting our great union. And last, his drive to deliver for every person in this country. And that starts with our economy. It's time for a fresh start. It's time for a clean start. It's time for Tom.
Well, good morning. It's very good to see you. Welcome. Families across the United Kingdom are facing a moment of crisis. It's becoming harder for people to simply get by. For so many, there is more month than pay. And we're facing danger abroad, division in our politics, an economy saddled with debt, and a creeping sense of despair about our collective future. This is a defining moment for us. It's a defining moment for our country, it's a defining moment for our party, and it's going to test the values on which we stand. I'm going to talk about economic policy today, but for me, for Conservatives, leading on the economy is not only a question of policy. It's a question of values, it's a question of mission, a question of our task and our purpose. We have been charged with the mission of advancing the interests of the British economy and the British people. They have asked us to hold ground for them, to secure the possibility of prosperity for each of them. They have asked us not only to hold the line, but to advance their aspirations, to move them and their children more confidently into the future, to hear them and to respond to them, and most importantly, to serve them, advancing all of us towards a future with a fairer, stronger, and more resilient economy. They've asked us to advance, and yet we have retreated. In a moment that is so desperate for so many, when our service is most needed, we have retreated. We have retreated into the pettiness of politics that is more about personality than principle. We have retreated into division when we desperately need unity, when our nation needed our party to function, we retreated into faction. When the moment demanded service, we delivered scandal. This is a crisis of purpose, of leadership, and of trust. We have been divided and distracted when we need to be united, responsive, and committed to our future and to the future of our people. I'm sorry, but I cannot accept retreat. We should not accept retreat. We must return to service. We need leadership with a renewed sense of mission. Leadership that sees beyond divisive politics and delivers results. Leadership that will return government to the service of our economy, our people, and our country. It describes our path forward together. It summarizes our advance orders for the next decade. It allows us to move forward together, afresh, optimistic, enthusiastic, confident, post-Brexit, and ready to seize the moment anew. That is why I'm introducing my 10-year plan for growth. It will return our government to the service of the British people and the British economy. It will make our economy stronger, our society fairer, and make our country more resilient. And it will do it by returning to the core values that unite us all as Conservatives. I believe in liberty and the low taxes necessary to defend it. I believe in responsibility and the honesty essential to delivering it. And I believe that with a clean start and with a return to service, we can ensure the prosperity of homes and families in every part of the country, stronger, fairer, and more resilient. I believe that a clean start that returns us to the service of the people will produce a brighter future. Our economy should be advancing, not retreating. Yet millions of people are opening bills with dread, not knowing what they'll have to cut to pay for what they need. They're filling up their car, wondering what it will cost to get to work the next day or the next month. And every day, families are seeing their savings being steadily eroded and wondering, will this be over by Christmas? This just isn't sustainable. It's not fair. It's not right. We must act. Like all Conservatives, I want people to keep more of their own money. I believe that we should cut the cost of government wherever we can, but this isn't an auction. I'm not here to bid for the highest or the lowest on every tax policy. I'm here to make the case that our economy can only prosper if we believe that people, not Westminster, know best how to spend their money. I know the pain that families are feeling now, and that is why my first pledge is to take fuel duty down by 10 pence a litre. My second is to reverse the national insurance rise. Now, this isn't about percentages. It's about jobs. It's about families. It's about workers. That's why I didn't vote for the increase then, and I wouldn't do so now. But that's not enough. We need to go further. I want to ensure that we cut the right taxes and get the right results. Our investment incentives are amongst the worst in the OECD. That means that it's less attractive to invest in the UK than it should be. That fewer businesses buy machinery, train their staff, and plan for the long term. Now, economists call that productivity, and they tell us that we don't have enough of it. What that really means is that we don't create enough, we don't create fast enough, and we don't sell well enough. Now that means that every hour, British workers are not getting the return on their effort that they should, and people across our country are losing out. We can fix it. Businesses can invest more in technology and training to drive up real pay, not inflation. But they can only do it if we change the incentives. And that means making it cheaper for companies to invest in their future. That is why I'm committing to ensuring businesses have the certainty they need to invest for the long term by introducing a programme of permanent full expensing, giving firms the confidence they need to plan for future growth. The United Kingdom, under my leadership, will have the most investment-friendly tax system in the OECD within 5 years. But let me make clear, tax cuts cannot be the only round in the magazine. My 10-year strategy for growth goes beyond taxes. What we need is deregulation to allow companies to thrive. Not because all regulation is bad, a market needs rules and a way to enforce them, but technology moves fast and often outpaces the regulators. So even when well-intended rules can become stifling, we need to find ways to change them. We need regulations that serve the best interests of our people and our economy, and those written for a different time and a different order need particular attention. I want to seize one of the biggest economic benefits of Brexit that we haven't yet grasped. I'm talking about the EU's Solvency II regulations. EU rules that force British insurers to sit on dead money that they're not allowed to invest. I will urgently reform these rules to bring these savings to life, employing people, starting businesses, building homes, and giving families a chance. To be clear, that will mean around £100 billion of British savers' money that can be put to work regenerating our communities and building homes. That's dead money breathing new life into our communities. The truth is that the last government hasn't moved far enough or fast enough. We need a clean start to bring energy and determination. And on this, we need to escape the EU's regulatory orbit now. Brexit has given Britain the chance to do better, and I will deliver. That's how we will harness this country's full potential. Because talent isn't exclusive to Telford. Brain power is no greater in Brighton. And I can tell you, certainly from my position on the green benches, IQ in Islington is certainly not higher than in Inverness. It neglects an opportunity for prosperity for us all. The Northern Research Group talk about spanning the divide and about ensuring that opportunity is spread across the country. I entirely agree. That is why I will equalise funding across all our regions, making sure that spending on innovation, infrastructure, and transport is spread fairly so that growth can follow. A clean start requires serving all of Britain. Now, my friend Jake Berry speaks about wanting a vocational Oxbridge in the north. He's right. I want one in every region. That is why I will commit to creating new institutes of technology across every major town and city in the United Kingdom so that every child has a chance to a world-class technical we'll be right back. many of us are struggling to access the services we need, to see the doctors we want, struggling to feel safe and secure in our homes. Take the NHS. We're putting in record investment without seeing the outcomes we need. Now, I know that even the best trained and most dedicated teams need targets. Take a simple measure. The four-hour A&E pledge was last met in 2015. People deserve better. We expect better. I will deliver better. As a first and immediate step, I would reintroduce a binding A&E and referrals target and hold NHS leaders accountable for it. But we won't just focus on the symptoms. On my first day as Prime Minister, I will bring together experts from the NHS, the wider public sector, the military, the private sector, and the voluntary sector to bust through this NHS backlog, copying the success of the vaccine task force that delivered the first vaccine here in the United Kingdom before anywhere else. Focus matters. Delivery matters. Competence matters. Finally, we need the kind of clean start that will make our economy and society more resilient. From COVID to the energy crisis, we have learnt that even if we get everything right, our country and our economy is exposed to threats at home and abroad. A responsible government is one that plans ahead, that thinks about the future, not just the present. One that takes steps to ensure that we are not vulnerable, and that those who try to harm us fail. I've warned about this many, many times before, about the vulnerability that we face in our supply chains and our energy. We all remember the desperate times when we rushed to secure protective equipment on faraway runways, and we still found ourselves short. And we all feel the pain of higher oil and gas prices now. That is why I will introduce an energy resilience plan to ensure that the United Kingdom has dependable power produced at home or sourced from trusted allies. That's the only way we can truly protect our sovereignty. It's the only way we can keep household bills low. It's the only way that we can keep our businesses competitive. That means more clean energy. It means
more nuclear.
It means creating a strategy to ensure that we aren't dependent on China to produce or process our critical minerals or on hostile states for our gas. And it means working with our allies to ensure that where we do import energy, we do not compromise our values or our alliances. That is the only way that we can tackle the weaponization of our energy markets by hostile states. Let me say now, if we do not grasp this issue, we are giving ground to our enemies who will ruthlessly exploit it. Ladies and gentlemen, this great country of ours is at a crossroads. We are faced with some of the most daunting challenges at home and abroad. We need serious leadership. We need to tackle the cost of living. We need a 10-year plan for growth. We need bold leadership to deliver a return to service. I am ready to serve. I am ready to lead. We need a clean start. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Now, I've been asked to take a question from the BBC. I suppose that's traditional. Brian, there's a fellow just behind you.
Thank you. Tom, that was a very detailed policy speech, actually. There was a lot of stuff in there that you wanted to announce. But how realistic really are you about this bid to be leader, given the strength of the field and also the way that the contest is already shaking out? So is this really all about just becoming foreign secretary in someone else's government?
No.
And also, if I might also ask if you have any reaction to the BBC Panorama story that broke this morning about the SAS killing unarmed men in Afghanistan.
Let me be extremely clear. I did not enter this race for any other purpose than to champion the values that I stand on and to lead the country that I love. That is why I am here. This is not a compromise position. This is not a negotiating strategy. This is a plan, and we're going to deliver it. I'm going to say something else because I think it's important. The Conservative Party is going to need an election after this to hold our party together. There is no way that anyone who makes it to the last two should either offer or accept a compromise that goes behind the backs of Conservative Party members. Now, you asked about the Panorama story. I'm afraid I only heard a little bit of it on the radio this morning. So let me answer what I know. I know that between 2005 and 2009, when I was serving in Afghanistan, I met many extraordinary, courageous, determined, and brave people serving our country. I know that during my time in Afghanistan, I neither saw nor heard any of these accusations. And I know that any investigation, any accusation, will be investigated fully by the Ministry of Defence. And that's not just because it's the right thing to do for the victims, or potential victims, or alleged victims. It's the right thing to do for the British military, because we stand on our values and standards as a country, and the military especially is absolutely reliant on those values and standards to maintain the ethos and discipline in war that is essential to victory. So I have absolutely no doubt that if there is any truth to these accusations, then the MOD will sort it out. Sam Coates.
Mr. TUGENDHAT, first of all, you just talked about the need for an election. How soon do you think there should be an election? Are you talking about cutting short this parliament? Down the road, in another leadership contest launch, it's incredible to believe that there's more than one at the moment, Dominic Raab has just said that this is no time to learn on the job. He's right, isn't he? And finally, you opened your speech by talking about Britishness. You've also talked about being a dual national. You have a French mother. What have you learned from that, by being a dual national?
Sure. Well, I think the first thing I've learned about being a dual national is that I should have chosen my mother better when I decided to go into politics. There's only so many things I can change, Sam. That's not one of them. The reality is that the job of Prime Minister is unlike every other job in government. It's not a management job. It's not a departmental job. It's a job that demands vision and leadership. It demands a willingness to serve. This is no time to learn. What this is a time to look at a record of service, a record of delivery, under the most difficult and trying conditions around the world, and to see that this isn't learning on the job. This is putting all that experience to work on the job, and the best job and the hardest job in the United Kingdom. There is 2 years to go before a general election, at least now. There is no mandate for an early one. What there is a mandate for a new leader. What we need is we need a new leader to deliver. And when I am Prime Minister, I will be rolling out a new deal for Britain that will demonstrate how we're delivering before I go to the country and ask them to trust us again. Because we need to rebuild trust, and we're only going to do it if we get a clean start and the right team around that table. Thank you. Andy. Andy Bell?
Is he here?
We've lost Andy.
Great shame. ITV News. Two questions, Tom, if you don't mind. Firstly, do you now regret voting for Remain in the referendum? And secondly, what is the biggest difference between you and Boris Johnson?
I'm not sure I know how to answer the second question. I could start quite a long chapter in a book on that one. I think what's important is to look to the future, not the past. I think the real challenge in the United Kingdom is that while we've got Brexit done, we haven't made Brexit deliver. And that's what I'm promising to do. When I am leader of this country, when I am Prime Minister, I will lead a government that brings talent from across the party, that recognises that however you voted in the past does not mean that you're any less committed, any less determined to deliver for all of our homes, our communities, our families. Of course you are. The reason my colleagues stood as Conservative members of Parliament, the reason we are lucky to have such extraordinary talent in our party, at Westminster and in council chambers across the country, the reason that the Conservative Party is the natural party of government is because we are a party that prioritises service and delivery. And that is exactly what we will do. When I am leader, we will get back to serving the British people and make sure that the leadership of the party serves the membership to deliver the values that we all share. That's how I'm going to be Prime Minister here. Well, as I say, there are many differences. He had to pay a lot of money to hand over his citizenship. I'm not allowed to give up mine.